above for that smart question, but that's an easy one to start with. The quatrefoil evolved out of the practice. For many years, I made paintings that were organized into horizontal bands with circles in them. And at a certain point, those seemed to be too passive. You know, the way that you would read them wasn't active enough. And so I decided to restructure them. Instead of having these kind of repeating horizontal lines, I created a grid where I just upended it so that the grid itself became less stable structurally. And the circles, I inserted them into the grid that was now this diamond shape, and it immediately made a flower, which was both attractive and terrifying, because it's probably the worst thing I could think of as a female artist to address would be this flower shape, right? But it also seemed like in many ways it was resonant as a form, in part because of the way it reflected the human body. You know, there's a top and a bottom and two sides, and there's something about that interior space in between those four shapes that's really compelling and intriguing, again, because of the way it relates to the body. And it's a form that means something different at one size, like the size of your head, and something quite different when it's larger in scale. And then there's the way that the form reappears or is present in like everyday vernacular culture. Like you see it a lot in architecture, you see it in design, you see it everywhere. So there's something about that form and its persistence that made me want to look into this shape more. So doing research on the quatrefoil, I mean, there's a lot about heraldry, and the form itself is this kind of symbolic female form where it represents a portal of sorts, which is also exciting to me. So what at first seemed dangerous and scary because of its connection to other ideas suddenly became richer because of its possibility for meaning in all these other ways. So it's a form that I feel will always be present in the work. I mean, that seems like a strange pronouncement, but it's such a part of my vocabulary now, it's hard to imagine it losing its potential for meaning.
Say a portal, but then did you guys see the poster on the way in?
Yes.
So we were talking about vulgarity earlier in the other room. And the notion of how you can be, because painting is, it's either well-behaved or it's like, it's seldom vulgar. And I just wanted you to talk, because I thought, I was like standing out there looking at the title and looking at those images and thinking, this is amazing, this is great. Because you feel like, yeah, well, I'm not going to say anymore, I'm going to let you talk
now. I think that painting's always been my first love, and maybe because of that, because of the weight of history, because there's so much about painting that has to do with taste and the way painting performs, with the way it performs as an object and as a commodity, and the way it performs in architecture as this kind of accessory to the space, that makes me want to not only participate in the tradition because I love it, but to disrupt it because of the way it's become decorative or kind of neutralized, or the way it's been disempowered by its the way it's used. So often what I try to do is make paintings that are connected to this history painting that I love, but disrupt it as a way of activating it and making it more lively.
Yeah. I mean, we're talking about this large painting in the and you see pattern to it, you see certain things kind of repeated, but then if you structure, but then as you keep looking at the painting, it starts to undo itself. So the pattern and chaos dance around each other, and neither of them wins, right? And I think, in a way, it's like we don't, the legacy of painting seems to me one of the legacies of painting is Frank Stella saying, what you see is what you see, and then you get it all at once, and then you don't have to look at it again. Right? And then how do you, as a painter, I mean, I would think one of the issues would be, how do you get them to look again? Or how do you get them to keep looking? Because the world is built on distraction, right? And the whole notion of distraction is you see it, but you don't have to pay attention to it. You consume it, and you go to the next distraction, and the next distraction. In a way, within all of our network of distractions, how do you get someone to pay attention to anything, something, long enough to have that moment of self-reflection, right? And I think, in a way, one of the things I've often, this is obviously not turning into a question. Sorry. One of the critic in me yapping away again. I mean, one of the things I've thought about is how does Judy stop me and make me look again? Like this painting over here, which I think is your latest painting.
Oh, that one is, but they happened.
I mean, it's like, you feel like it's a structure, and then the longer you look at it, it's like three things or four things are going on at the same time, and none of them wins out over any other one. You have to hold it all in your head, or your visual sight at once, and then it becomes, impossible. One of the things, just to kind of extend this further now that I've had this thought, that's what's great about Jackson Pollock's best paintings. You can't memorize them. Right? And that's what I think she's doing in that painting without even looking like Pollock. Right? Which is like, and the whole problem with Pollock is everybody wanted to look like him, right? And then there's a lot of bad painting produced. Because you can't really make something look like someone else unless you share your meaning, but that's another story. We both do that.
Wow. Well, this is certainly going down a road I never expected me. That's funny, that whole notion of looking at painting over time, because I think that, well, maybe all artists, but certainly painters, are aware of the preciousness of time that you have in front of a viewer and the way people generally look at things. I mean, we've all, like, I know you all artists are in art world, we've all read a lot about how much time people spend looking at a work of art, and it's like roughly around 7 seconds. And so a lot of what has motivated me from the very beginning to make paintings is to try to make paintings that require being seen first person. And that always, for me, has something to do with the relationship of the painting to the human body. Like, there's this one-to-one relationship in terms of scale, and then there's what happens in terms of the materiality of the painting and how that can be complicated or used to make the paintings there are multiple kinds of experiences of time that I'm trying to create these paintings. And part of it is through the pattern, which suggests a kind of regular time, but it's disrupted through the drawing because the way that they're drawn, they're not exactly regular. So there's that sense of time. And then there's often some kind of color interaction, which causes an after image or some kind of optical disturbance, which happens in another kind of time. And then the drips happen immediately. Like they happen in the process, and there's a very specific and actual time to the drips in the painting. And I think that there's something really important about trying to accommodate all those experiences of time into the painting, because I'm trying to make paintings that are vital, that are paintings that are like life. And I think we've all experienced life where there are moments that seem endless and go on forever, which I hope is not the way this talk feels. And then there's time that just literally flies by, like when you're really having a great time and it's over too soon. So I'm trying to give the paintings that kind of elasticity of experience to make them more like life.
Because we inhabit all those different times at the same time, but we might only be aware of one of those times that we're inhabiting. Right? But we're inhabiting the time with the sun going around the earth. We're inhabiting the time with the, you know, whatever our routine is, and then there's the family time, and there's this time. We're in all of them at once, right?
Yeah.
But somehow, how do you acknowledge that? There's no overlapping, I mean, not overriding the ocean of time, but I feel like in your work you kind of get all of those colliding together or woven together, somehow integrated. And yet at the same time, at least in that painting, right away you see also all the differences, right?
Right, because one day, even though every day, there's a day after another day after another day, every day is different.
Right.
So, it's to try to acknowledge that, not acknowledge it, to just make that present in the paintings.
The other thing I just wanted, when I asked you that earlier, is people connected you to the pattern and decoration, and yet I feel like you've, as much as you're connected, you're completely separate.
Barely see it.